welcome to the big fat quiz of the year. Yes, it's big, yes, it's fat, but it can't help it. It's got a thyroid problem. This show is like a pub quiz, but there's no booze and everyone's famous. Sort of like games night at the Priory. And you can play along at home. All you need is a pen, a piece of paper, some leftover Quality Street, half a bottle of sherry, and 2 hours with nothing better to do. I'm going to be asking the questions this evening about the year's events, and our teams are going to be asking themselves why they agreed to publicly flaunt their ignorance. Let's meet them now. First up, we've got Charlie Brooker and David Mitchell. We've got Rob Brydon and Claudia Winkleman. And we've got Russell Brand and Jonathan Ross. As is tradition on this show, I hope you've come up with funny pub quiz team names. Anything?
Yeah. Define funny.
Just a pub
if
quiz.
If they promise to laugh after whatever we say, it'll seem okay, right?
Yeah! The deal has been struck.
Oh, this is marvellous. We were thinking maybe ignorance and want. Because thank you. That was an extremely fake laugh.
Ignorance and want.
Yeah, because
and who would be who?
We wouldn't specify. You could decide.
Ooh, press the red button now. Nice. OK, have you come up with a team name?
We have. This show, as you know, is one of the longest shows on British television. So, for Claudia and I, it's as though we're starting out on life's journey together. Therefore, we shall be known as... the Newlyweds.
You look a little bit frightened, like you've been tricked into this, Claudia.
Yeah, I thought we were going to be called Rob and Claude, but I'll go with Newlyweds. Yeah, that's that seems cosy.
That's all right, isn't
it? Yes!
Is the Rohypnol wearing off now?
We've kicked off with a Rohypnol joke. We're not even a minute in. We haven't even got to Jonathan and Russell. Have you come up with a pub quiz team name?
I thought we should come out here as the Moral Minority.
I thought, using the technique that that Jed would use, because one's called John and one's called Edward, we should call ourselves Jedwood.
Beautiful. OK, teams, and you at home, we start with January and February. Of course we do, this isn't fucking Memento. Here's a reminder of some of the stories that hit the headlines earlier this year. Charismatic billionaire and cricket entrepreneur Sir Alan Stanford was charged over a multi-billion dollar fraud. Suspicions were raised when someone charismatic was associated with cricket. Porn barons asked the US government for a financial bailout. Obama told Congress it was important for America to pull together. Good. The crisis in the porn industry came after the ill-judged Subo Does Dallas. We're not going to show you a clip, don't cry. Right, on to the questions for January and February. Right. In January, the governor of New York said, "We had a miracle on 34th Street. I believe now we've had a miracle on the Hudson."
Yes.
What was he talking about? Okay, have you all got something for that?
Do we want to win?
All right, second question. Question number two. Barack Obama was inaugurated in January, pledging to reform healthcare, close Guantanamo Bay, and improve relations with the Middle East. But what triumph later in the year prompted him to declare, "I got the sucker"?
Ay, 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 ay.
Yes! Ay, 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 ay.
Oh, I know that. Yes, 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 yes. Well done.
Jonathan, what? Those aren't your glasses.
What you're looking at here, Carr, is a masterclass in quiz psychology. Because when they look over here now, they see a movie star and a scientist.
Sorry, you're wearing those glasses to attempt to look like a nerd to impress David Mitchell.
Tell that there is no glass in those glasses. which immediately makes me think that you're a spy working for a poor country.
I think it's the frames that convey wisdom anyway. Yeah. The glass, anyone can get glass. You look very wise in them.
And what's nice, when I wear these, it makes me feel like I'm sitting next to Megan Fox with a beard.
That's who it reminds me of.
Right, have you all written something down for that one? All right. Question number three. Here's Christian Bale having a frank exchange of views with a crew member on the set of Terminator Salvation.
Oh, da-da-da-da, like this in the background. What the fuck is it with you? Oh, good for you. And how was it? I hope it was fucking good because it's useless now, isn't it? Fuck's sake, man, you're amateur. I want to fucking kick your fucking ass. You know, shut up for a second, all right? You don't fucking understand what it's like working with actors. Seriously, man, you and me, we're fucking done professionally. Fucking ass.
It's interesting, he hasn't got an accent anymore. He hasn't got an accent that any other human has. He's been so destroyed by transatlantic travel and success that he can't speak like a normal human.
Russell, Christmas future. Okay, so what I want to know about Christian Bale is what was he angry about?
Oh.
Simple as that. What was he angry about? He was definitely angry about something.
Is this making you nervous that I'm writing?
I love the fact that you're writing. It feels like she's in control.
Are you being filthy? Okay.
I'm not being filthy, but I'm thinking filthy.
Now, how much... Oh, go on.
No, we're just enjoying our jokes. But we're keeping them private because we know what can happen.
Except for us. No, no. OK. Now, how much do you remember about the music of 2009? I'm about to put you in the capable hands of a man who's so 2008, he makes LaRue look 2008. That's right, it's Channel 4 News' Jon Snow. That's the correct response, yes. Can't believe you're
not.
What I want to know is which hit song is he reporting on here?
A woman accused of spousal abuse took to the stand today as details of her gambling addiction were read out to the jury, along with allegations that she had stunned her partner with a love glue gun and subsequently attempted to cover up her wrongdoing by bluffing with her muffin. Throughout the trial, the defendant remained entirely impassive, with court reports noting that it was impossible to read her expression.
So he was bluffing with her muffin this year.
Well, here's a shock. I actually know the answer to this, which is...
No, it's about popular music.
Yes, I know. That's why it's a shock, Jimmy, because I actually know the answer. I'm just instructing my wife now to write it down.
Thank you, honey bun.
Oh, we're still very much in the honeymoon phase. I mean, anything could happen by the end of the show, but at the moment, we are getting on like a house on fire.
Right. Go, fine.
These two...
We haven't got a clue. No, I think Charlie has a very vague idea that it might be something he hasn't heard. I'm convinced it's something I haven't heard. But it's difficult for me to select from all the billions of things I haven't heard which one it is.
Yeah, if it's not on Phil Collins' No Jacket Required, you really haven't got much of a chance.
Well, actually, you're way behind, because just the other day, I was writing in a newspaper how I've also bought Susan Boyle's album. I've now bought two albums, and have consequently concluded that music is shit.
Well, good luck with that question.
That means your entire record collection are the tracks that we put on when we want people to leave at the end of the park. That's all you've got.
I think, basically, deep down, I want myself to leave.
This is meant to be a festive quiz, not an intervention.
Pity!
Yeah, marvellous.
And for your final question, it's over to my brother from another mother, 50 Cent.
Hi, Jimmy. It's been a great year for me. I got 2 million followers on Twitter, but can you tell me who tweeted this in February and why? Hell's teeth. We could be here for hours. Ass, poo, and whittle.
What?
What did you say?
Ass, poo, and whittle.
Ah.
Oh, I know that. But it sounded much more interesting when he said it, didn't it? It was like, ass, poo, and whittle. It was like, really, yeah, ass, poo, and whittle. Blah, blah, blah.
Jonathan, I'm going to take responsibility for our team. When you stray into an area which I think may cause a national scandal, I'm going to raise my hand. Your impression of Fiddy was that territory. Although my barometer for judging scandals has been damaged. Can't you?
I won't do Fiddy.
The married couple and the civil partnership here are done. It's time for some answers. Yeah. I asked you what the governor of New York was talking about when he said there'd been a miracle on the Hudson. What'd you all get?
Emergency plane landing.
OK, and you've gone for David and
we
Charlie?
Went for
plane crash, nice, the nice type. It's one of those ones that gives you hope that you might survive a plane crash. Because now, before you'd have just thought, if the plane started going down, you'd think, I'm definitely going to die. Whereas now you can think, I might be in one of those one in a billion happenings.
Well, let's go to the definitive answer for this question. Russell, Jonathan.
That's the answer. We've drawn it there. We've surpassed language and gone straight to this visual image of an aeroplane landing on the Hudson River.
Yeah. If the answer had been a shark with sunglasses on, I would have given you a point.
If you would ask a question to which that was the answer, Jimmy, I think this quiz would be a lot more fun.
Is that meant to be a plane crashing?
Yeah, it's a plane, it's a nice...
It's just crash, Jim! It's not going to be in optimum condition. From the pilot!
But I was wasn't that a lovely story? Wasn't it great? It was so nice to hear about people escaping. The only escape story that cheered me up more was when Peter Andre finally got away from Jordan. That was it.
Well, I can tell you, you are all right. He was, of course, talking about the amazing actions of pilot Chelsea Sullenberg.
But my aeroplane's been ticked now. That is a good thing that you have done that. Well done. My school weren't like that. That would have been another letter home. He's done it again.
OK, it was the actions of pilot Chelsea Sullenberg, who successfully averted a plane crash by landing on the Hudson River. Well, I say successfully averted. He basically crashed a plane into a river and became a hero. It's an excellent bit of spin by him, I think.
Yeah, if you crash on into a building, you're some kind of terrorist.
Russell? Russell, I think your barometer might be on the fritz again. OK, question number two. What made Barack Obama say, I got the sucker? What have you all got?
Swatted a fly.
Swatted a fly and he said, I got the sucker. What have you gone for, David?
We went for he killed a fly. I wouldn't argue with swatted, I think it's...
OK, and Russell and Jonathan?
We initially thought Henry the Hoover, the sucker, he had...
We did that as a joke based around the word sucker.
But then we put, he killed a fly because...
Because we do would... want the point.
Yeah, we would like to win.
It's important for us to win this quiz to be redeemed. And Jonathan is a scientist.
Let's have a little look.
The signature characteristic of our... Sorry, I'm going to start over. Hey! Get out of here.
That's the most persistent fly I've ever seen. Nice.
Now, where were we? That was pretty impressive, wasn't it? I got the sucker.
It's on, it's right there.
It's right there. You want to film that? There it is.
He's gone power crazy, though, because first of all, he kills a fly, which wasn't really harming him. Then he boss someone and says, yeah, that was great, wasn't it? Aren't I great? Then he goes to the camera and get a shot of that. He's, like, directing it. It goes to his head immediately.
Film this Afghan village. I'll fuck that up and all.
Okay. I think the interview is interesting there, because he said to him, that is the most persistent fly I've ever seen, which I don't believe him. If he's seen equally persistent flies, maybe one or two more persistent flies. He's trying to suck up to Obama, saying, you're being troubled by that fly, but that's no reflection on you, because that is the most persistent fly I've ever seen.
It wouldn't be beyond the realms of possibility, would it, for a White House minion to have placed an already dead fly.
Oh, I like it.
No one would notice it. Then you go, ah, look what I did.
OK, you heard Christian Bale having a little bit of a meltdown. What prompted it? What was he upset about? Charlie, what have you got?
Oh, yeah, it was a human. It was basically a human being. Because, I mean, I think if it's pretty upsetting if you're Christian Bale. And a human, a human walks into your field of vision, reminding you there's other people breathing your air, living in your world. So it was a guy fiddling with a light. Not, it was a light. What am I saying that in a menacing way?
No, just yeah, a little bit, yeah. So, right, then what have you got, Rob?
It was one of the crew who walked in front of his eye line when he was doing a scene, and he went bonkers. He is Batman, and of course he's Welsh, so he's a Welsh Batman. So when Commissioner Gordon says, right, we've got a criminal terrorising the town, he says, right, who's this joker we're dealing with now?
Russell, of course, you're in Hollywood. Do you, would, if someone walked in front of your field of vision, would you go...
I'm angry that you're in mine now.
Well, I can only apologise. What did you put down for this, Jonathan?
We put down. He had been poorly lit, which made him look less bat-like.
You don't get a point for that.
Why?
What? What?
That, yeah, no, that, yeah. I think the reason behind that is that that's not the right answer, I think.
That's not fair.
That might be partly.
OK, right, next one. You heard Jon Snow reporting on a popular tune of 2009. What was it?
Is it that? Is that what it is? I literally, I was just guessing. I was trying to interpret. I don't listen to music and sounds and things like that. And he's only got two flipping records.
And it's not on either of them.
Where have you been? Where have you been that you don't hear music?
Clapham!
So you've gone poker face, you've gone...
Pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-poker face.
And okay. We've gone Lady Gaga.
Yes, well, we wrote the name as well, Lady Gaga.
Mm. I think you all get a point. You've got it right.
Yeah,
let's have a little bit of a listen. Oh, you've heard this, have you?
Yes. I have never, ever before seen a woman lactate that violent. But did you like it now that you've heard it properly?
No.
It's why not?
It's all right. I'm not sorry it stopped.
Do you ever... Do either of you ever dance?
No.
No.
I'm
maybe.
Speaking for you.
Yeah. I bet you dance at home. What about if you've just had a banging shower and you hear that? Would you just do a little thing with the towel?
No.
Bust a move?
I really wouldn't.
What would you do, John, if that comes on and you've stepped up?
Man, I'll work it.
Can we hear that again? I'd like to see Jonathan show
us. No, I'm not
going
to do it now. I need to be naked. See, you've got to bust the move. That's what I'm talking about. But I'd like to see... Come on, now let's see the fellas have a go.
No, no, this isn't...
Come on, let's see a bit.
OK, let's have from David and Johnny.
What?
I refuse.
So
why? What?
Okay.
What?
No,
what
I like.
What makes you think I was going to do that?
It's a generation game.
I like the way you have two.
Fuck off. I'm hired to sit here and be sarcastic.
Like some. His name is Jonathan. Leave him alone.
This is actually. The world is full of people trying to make people who don't want to dance dance at weddings and things. Go on, have a dance. You want to, really? No, I really don't want to. I know my own mind.
David,
I don't want to.
David.
Now it's happening to people on television.
David. Charlie, I bet you do dance.
No.
I bet you
no,
do.
No, no, no. I have spent. I've probably. If you accumulated it, I've probably spent 6 months of my life being people trying to drag me onto dance floors.
And
what is fun about it? I'm like a frightened horse on a frozen lake.
That's such a lovely image.
I think it's good that them two have found each other now. They will be happy together.
The curmudgeons.
Maybe we should change the name of our team to the curmudgeons, to the people who won't join in.
Or maybe change the name of the team to the men who will dance if they win.
Yes.
No.
I think that's something
for us
all to aim for.
Support for that.
Yeah. What sort of Reich is this you're establishing?
Finally, OK, 50 Cent asked you about a notorious tweet. What have you all got?
It was Stephen Fry stuck in a lift.
OK, you concur?
Yes.
At Stephen Fry. We put down. That's the proper Twitter name.
Nice.
I think because we've done the proper Twitter name, we should get the point that you cruelly took away from us earlier, Carl.
No. Shall we see how the scores are looking at the end of our first round? I can tell you that David and Charlie have 5. Rob Brydon, Claudia Winkleman, 5. Russell Brand, Jonathan Ross, 4 points. Right, that's the end of the first part. See how many New Year's resolutions you can break in 2 minutes. Back in a bit. Welcome back to the Big Fat Quiz of the Year. And so we leave January and February to ill-advisedly move in with a younger March and April. The Pope claimed that condoms don't stop the spread of AIDS. Fine, what's the matter with a 65-year-old virgin in a dress giving us all sex tips he got off his imaginary friend? And the BNP won 2 seats in Brussels at the European Parliament. It sickens me. They go over there, taking their jobs. Jonathan, you've had a good year. You were immortalised by Madame Tussauds.
They came to...
Can you... Jonathan,
I'm what I look
Jonathan,
like. Jealous.
that's envy. Like, Jonathan, can you do the ungainly pose?
Yes. It's a bit Richard Madeley. It's a bit. Is that not Richard? Yes, coming up, ponchos.
How dare you? No, I think I look more like a cross between Claire Balding and a regional weather woman.
Claire Balding, that is... That's who I was thinking. It's Claire Balding.
What is it? Why do people go to Madame Tussauds?
Oh, I mean, listen to you. You don't dance, you don't go and look at...
When did you last go to Madame Tussauds, John?
Well, to see myself.
You went to see yourself?
But while we were there, I was... How sad is this? I was hanging around near my figure, thinking people would say, oh, my God, it's you, let's get a picture of you with you. And then a couple came over, well, I'll tell you, I think they were a Japanese couple, and went, shashin, photo, photo. I went, of course, when I sat down, went, no, shashin, they wanted me to take a picture of them with that, not realising that was me.
Big Claire Balding fans.
So I just took it, yeah.
Right, let's have some questions, shall we? More quiz for you. Gail Trimble from Oxford's Corpus Christi College became an unlikely sex symbol this year when her team won University Challenge. What I want you to tell me is why the team was subsequently disqualified.
Oh. Almost head-butted me then.
We're about to hit a rocky patch. Yes?
No, I'm
no, no, go on, go on, go on, go on. No, I left it.
You see,
no,
you see the position?
No, no, it's too late for that. Care what I got to say, but you're going to write whatever you want anyway. Seems no point in me sitting here, is there? Because you don't listen to a word I say. I try and chip in with something helpful. There.
You already know the answer. The honeymoon period is officially over.
Well, she doesn't listen, does she? She won't listen. She refuses to listen.
OK, next up, we have a Say What You See puzzle. Have a look at these pictures and see if you can work out what headline they're spelling out. Could not be simpler.
Easy. Easy.
That's really good.
We have cracked your code, Mr. Blofeld.
OK. When Obama visited the UK in March for the G20 summit, Gordon Brown presented him with a magnificent antique pen holder crafted from the timbers of a 19th-century British warship. What did Obama give Brown in return?
I know.
OK. We asked... I hush your mouth, no one's getting laid till afterwards.
I can pop off in breaks.
Okay, all right. We asked the velvet voiced Tim Minchin, one of the breakthrough comedy stars of the year, to ask you a question. But instead, he went one better and he wrote us a whole song. So listen very carefully to the song that Tim Minchin has written for us, and I want to know what controversial internet service Tim is singing about. Ladies and gentlemen, Tim Minchin.
It's just like 1984. Have we no privacy no more? Can I have a little sleep outside the pub, say? Or a vomit near a subway? I use a postbox as a crapper without some omnipresent snapper catching me with my pants around my knees. Tin fully searchable 360 degrees. Understand that the neighbors might balk when I hang my happy sacrificial goat on my front porch. I can handle their contempt, but I do not consent to my goat playing a part in your creepy global experiment. It's just like 1984. Have we no privacy no more?
No privacy.
If I bump into Jimmy as he leaves an adult store carrying edible undies and a sex toy or four, the chance of our interception is a risk he's accepting. But that don't mean he wants his bag of butt plugs up on the net.
No, no butt plugs.
It's just like 1984. Well,
84. Well,
even the late Georgie Orwell.
Georgie Orwell. Yeah.
Would surely think he was here in a fiction if you tried to describe how far this shit's gone. Would presume you were taking the piss, being happy with technology like this, where you can sit and watch Jimmy on the big fat quiz, whilst peering into the letterbox of that swanky flat of his. It's just like 1984.
It's our friend Tim Minchin, so what I want to know is what was he singing about there?
Can you do this next?
Yep.
I can't believe you didn't feel the urge to bust a move to that banging tune. I was gone. I was looking over and you didn't move neither. You sat there stolid and unhappy. Stewing in your own middle-aged juices.
He's genuinely scared about that.
Oh, seriously, I think you're going to love it.
Dance on
you're going to love it. And I'm telling you, you dance, I guarantee you'll lose your virginity this year. Because if no one else offers, I'll do it.
think
what
I
if
do.
I'll take it for you?
You're going to fuck me up the arse, is that what you're saying? Oh, I'm so sorry. I
think it speaks volumes for Russell that his barometer didn't go off.
Hey, have you heard Rob do his little man trapped in a box voice? It is the best thing ever.
Do you think I'm some sort of performing monkey who can just be prodded to do his small man in a box voice whenever you...
Where are you? Somebody get me out.
How can he do it?
I think there's a small man actually trapped inside your body.
That's who I married!
Ah. The small man is about to enter into the box.
Can I get a taxi?
Can I ask you, have you ever employed that voice in the bedroom?
Well, it's the only way I can be aroused.
You could do it like that was your private part speaking.
Yeah.
You could say, I want to do this, and the little voice could say, Daddy likes it. Like that.
Can you, Rob, can you just say, in the man in the trapped in the box voice, can you just say, I don't like it in here, it's dark?
I don't like it in here, it's dark.
It's a hell of a talent.
It's incredible.
But I don't know what to do with it.
You could play big stadium gigs with that. Heavily mic'd, obviously.
Defeating the purpose entirely. Yeah. Okay, I can see you're all on tender hooks. Here are some answers for you. Okay, I asked you why Gail Trimble's team were disqualified from University Challenge. Did anyone get this? Oh, Claudia Winkleman.
Yes, because...
Hand up.
Yeah, well, they were disqualified, her team, because somebody on there, they sort of cheated, because they started off when they were a student, but by the time they got to the finals, they were no longer a student. They were working for an accountancy firm. Check me out.
That is absolutely correct. You get a point. Russell, you've gone for...
Well, I'm with Jonathan.
Yes.
And we did it as a team. And, in fact, he got this right. Not a student.
One of them was not a student. This is quite like University Challenge, isn't it?
Yeah.
This is as close as I'm...
University Challenge, they have buzzers and things. So I think it's fair to say it's a bit more dynamic.
This one ends in dancing.
Yeah.
My turn, yeah.
OK. The next question was a say-what-you-see puzzle. Surely you must have all got this.
This was good.
Yes.
Claudia, do you know what this story is?
Yes, rugby blood gets handled, because all of the boys, they were going on the pitch and they didn't want to hurt themselves, so they put the capsules that you buy from joke shops and they were, ow, ow, and they were taken off. Yeah.
Wasn't it so that they could be substituted off so you could get a better kicker on?
But absolutely right. It's Harlequins rugby player Tom Williams who used a joke shop blood capsule to fake an injury.
I like the fact they got it from a joke shop because yeah. What if they turn up and they run out of blood capsule and turn up with an arrow through his head? That's quite bad.
OK, I wanted to know what Barack Obama bought Gordon Brown in exchange for a beautiful antique pen holder.
Now, this is the first one where we don't genuinely know the answer. We've gone for a very amusing answer instead. We've written dead fly in a callback to the earlier round, which I'm sure will have the audience in stitches.
I'm mortified when I tell you that they've gone for that same excellent job.
Yes. But we genuinely thought that was the case.
I notice in brackets you've gone for...
DVDs, because we want the points as well as a joke.
What have you gone for, David?
We've gone for DVDs.
It was DVDs. It was kind of classic American films.
It's equivalent of... It's the sort of presidential equivalent of flowers from the petrol forecourt, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's DVDs that someone gave.
Three quarters of a bottle of whiskey.
Actually, I know a bit more information about that. That boat, what the pen thing was made out of, was actually used to liberate slave ships. So I think, right, the subtle subtext of that was, oh, here's a pen made from a boat to liberate slave ships, which I think Obama probably thought, oh, that's a dig because I'm black and everything, I'm the president. You're saying, remember, we can fuck you up, we made you, we can destroy you. So I think, have some DVDs, you mug. Watch them out of your peepa. The one what works.
Yes, he almost certainly said, you mug.
Well, they did actually say mug in American Chicago films in a very different dialect.
Well, how do they say it? Have you been working on your
you
American accent?
You mug!
That's a pirate.
You mug! Ah, you mug!
I could do a pirate if required.
You look like a pirate. However, can you do an American... You're trying to make it in films, and obviously the jury's out, but can you do...
There's no jury involved. This is one part of my career that is not subject to legal action.
do a southern accent for us. Do Billy Bob.
No way. I'm only playing me. I'm in films where I'm like this. It's all right, just turn there. And if I see something in the script and I think that person's not got hair like my hair, I take it out. If they say this is a short-haired man, I say, well, I don't think I'd like to be him.
Okay, Tim Minchin. Tim Minchin sang for us. Yeah. What I wanted to know was what was he singing about, the talented boy that he is? What have you got?
QVC for burglars. That's what it is. Mm. Google Map. All they do all day is look at it and say, that's a nice house, I'll go around there later. It's a disgrace.
It's not Google Map, it's Google Street View.
Oh, you're so pedantic. I've had it with you and your fake Welshness.
This is a quiz. In a quiz, you are rewarded for accuracy. Google Street View, Jimmy. Please do not award points to these two threats to national security and moral standards.
I used to love you on TV doing
your
little
voice.
Don't
try and faff around with your usual
little
voice. You got it wrong.
We're just saying, there's
too late. Too late. Talk to the arm because the hand. Talk to the. Don't talk. Points, please, Jimmy.
Oh, you will definitely get a point for that. It's the correct answer. You will not get a point. Oh. You boys.
It just doesn't go quite sort of far enough, Google Street View. It should be like they should have put a camera on top of a guy's head on a helmet and have him crawling in through sort of bathroom windows and lifting duvets and so you can just examine anyone.
Google Sleep View. See everyone sleeping. Anyone in the world, you can watch them sleep.
In the sort of detail a doctor might.
Okay, Google Street View. Point, point, no point. Now, here's a treat for
now
you.
Now then. Ho, 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 ho. Carry on.
Now, here's a treat for you. It's a bonus round. This one's about virals. OK, first one. This is Fatso the Cat. But by which name did he become better known when he achieved overnight fame on the internet? Write down your answers now.
I don't know.
OK, what name was he known as? He doesn't normally wear a hat. That's worth saying.
What do you call him?
He doesn't normally wear a hat.
He doesn't normally wear that hat. He's not famous for that hat. OK.
Is he the...
Try that. I don't know.
I know him.
OK. Have you all got something?
Yes.
OK, let's have a look and see how this cat got notoriety.
That's torture. The cat's going, what the fuck is going on? It's clearly they've stuck rods up its paws from behind. They're using a live cat as a puppet. That's disgusting.
So is that not going to be your third record purchase?
I don't like that. I don't like that. And, you know, in general, I'm kind of OK with a bit of cruelty to animals, but that goes too far.
OK, Rob, Claudia, you've gone for...
We didn't know, so we went for Santa Paws. We just went right.
You went with a very similar...
Well, actually, we initially went with Santa Claus, different pun, but still...
Slightly better.
Still, yeah, slightly better. We crossed out Santa Claus and put the funny internet cat, which I think you'll agree is broadly right.
Jonathan, Russell, you've gone with Keyboard
Cat.
We've
got Keyboard Cat.
Which is clearly the right answer.
Once you told us it wasn't his hat, we knew who he was. But there is another internet cat called the Spaghetti Cat, isn't there?
What does it do?
Eat spaghetti.
Nice.
You've had a lot of time on your hands.
I spent about 3 months just looking at cats on the internet.
I did a similar thing.
Okay. All right, next up.
I did one what was less vulgar for you, Rob.
It's nice. I like it when you like that.
OK, right, next one. A video of 7-year-old American David DeVore Jr. got over 34 million hits on YouTube this year. The video consisted of him talking to his father on a car journey. Where have they just been?
I know this. I've seen this.
Can you write something down?
It could have been anywhere, couldn't they?
Well, have a guess.
Right.
Name a place.
Yeah, that's great.
Oh, I'm just writing them up.
OK, you've all got something for this. You went for Charlie and David?
Redditch.
You might have been to Redditch. And that became an internet phenomenon.
You said guess. We guessed wrongly.
Your answer was?
We didn't know. We wrote a few and then we thought we could cross them out. We wrote fairground, McDonald's, golf, sports.
Incorrect. Well, I think Russell and Jonathan, you got...
The dentist. Hey, we've all been there, lol. We made it internet-friendly for you right there.
Little David had, of course, been to the dentist. Let's have a look at his not-at-all-hilarious reaction to painkillers.
How did it go? is this real life?
Yeah, this is real life. Stay in your seat. It's okay, bud. It's just from the medicine. Okay?
Is this going to be forever?
No. No, it won't be forever.
Your first one is cat torture. Now we're sort of a distressed child on some sort of horrendous narcotic. I mean, isn't the internet fun?
And to ask the final question in our virals bonus round, please welcome a very special guest. You love him, I love him, we all love him. It's Peter Andre. He's adorable! OK, so, how's your year been, first off?
Well, interesting. Emotional. It's been good.
Yeah, you had some hit singles, you had a hit album, that sort of thing. Let's talk about that stuff.
And no, actually, you're right. And I'm going to say it, my album's gone platinum. I'm so excited. But enough of that. How are you? Good. How are you, Russ? I haven't seen you for ages.
I'm all right, thanks, mate. I'm just doing a quiz.
Do you know, he was the first man and the only man I've ever kissed.
Oh.
Do you remember that? Do you remember that?
Your marriage was doomed from that day.
I know.
Do Jimmy this time. Add a bit of variety to your diet.
I'm going to pass the buck to David Mitchell, if you don't mind.
Guys, you were getting picked on a lot, eh, tonight?
Yeah, I was watching
you. Peter, do you not think dancing is a lovely thing? You like to dance, don't you?
Oh,
right, imagine if you'd never danced because you looked like that and you felt embarrassed. No, and then someone was kind enough to say,
you were getting,
a dance.
He was getting a lot of arse out the back. Honestly, you were
a lot of arse. We're back to that.
Can I get things slightly back on track here and away from the amount of arse David is getting?
For the first time tonight.
Yeah, but yeah. I came out to help him and I've just battered him. He's right. Now... I haven't battered him.
You come out to ask
I was
a
just
question.
Gonna say I put my foot in it. That's just gonna be worse. Let's forget it. Let's move on. Come on.
You've got a question for these
I
people.
I have got a question.
About it's a viral question.
That's not what I was out here for. Okay. It stunned the nation. It made Demi Moore cry. And was the most viewed clip in YouTube history. What was it?
Do we buzz that?
No, you write down.
No, you gotta write it down. Answer.
Okay, alright. Have you all got something down?
Finished.
Yes.
Okay. Okay, they've gone.
It's really good.
Oh!
Okay.
That's a hell of a picture, Jonathan.
Brilliant.
That's beautiful. That's like a passport photo.
When I first saw Subo, I thought it was the Gruffalo.
Russell?
Oh, yeah, don't say that. Poor cow.
Subo.
And you've gone for.
Really good choice.
Susan Boyle singing.
The album that you bought.
Yeah, but do you know? I mean, this you got it right. But do you know what she actually did on YouTube? What song she actually sang?
Right. We gave him a card. It's gone to his head.
I know.
He's
going,
did you know?
Over. So.
Ladies and gentlemen, Peter Andre. Yeah. Thank you. To brighten up our day. Right, let's have a look at the scores at the end of that. I can tell you that Russell Brand and Jonathan Ross have 10 points. Rob Brighton and Claudia have 9 points. David Mitchell, Charlie Brooker, the Dancing Queens are on 10 points. Time for a quick break now while Claudia records the Big Fat Quizzes, Big Fat Brother on E4 Plus One. See you in a minute. Welcome back to the Big Fat Quiz. We move on to May and June, when a nation mourned the news that Piers Morgan was tragically still alive. Let me remind you what else we were talking about. Jordan Split was all over the papers. She should be more careful getting out the car.
Right, I don't get it. Can you explain?
Iranian pro-democracy protesters used Twitter to spread the revolution. A typical posting read, "Death to the imperial dictatorship. P.S. Eight Cheerios for breakfast. Yum." Believe it or not, I've got some more questions for you. As regular viewers know, every year the children of Mitchell Brook Primary School in Neasden shun the conventional nativity play to perform one based on major news stories. Can you tell me what they're brilliantly acting out here?
Here's for the finger box.
OK, do not tell anybody.
We'll see about that.
Extra, extra. Read all about it.
Oh, no!
Why did you buy all these things?
Because my moat is all dirty. My duck needs a house.
And my husband likes to watch movies.
You're very naughty. Give it back.
It's adorable. They are adorable. That's Mitchell Brook Primary School there. God love them. And what I want to know was what news story were they acting out, OK? Second question. Who was heard around Westminster in May shouting, "Ayo, Girk Halley," while wielding a big knife? You look nervous, Russell, as if you're about to be charged.
Just sounds like a terrifying event. Let me tell you.
Michael Jackson, the king of pop, sadly popped his clogs. Take a look at this picture. Can you tell me what's going on here? This was one of the events after his death. What's happening here? Okay. And now it's back to my Channel 4 news brethren, Jon Snow. Reporting on another song of the year. Tell me what to go on or I'll murk you.
A man falsely accused of being mentally ill was celebrating today after he'd had his section order overturned. Local authorities claimed that the man was obsessed with sex and violence and unable to tell the difference between silence and a heavy bass line. In a brief statement to the press, the 24-year-old Londoner stated that whilst he understood that his behaviour might lead some to believe him to be unstable, he just thinks he's free. He added that he was overjoyed with the result, reiterating, "There's nothing crazy about me."
So I want to know, what song was he talking about there? Pretty simple. OK. I asked you what the children of Mitchell Brook Primary School were acting out. What did you all get? David, Charlie?
MP's expenses, we said.
MP's expenses.
MP's expenses.
The story they're acting out is the Daily Telegraph's uncovering of the MP expenses scandal, which was leaked by disaffected office workers who slowly and methodically photocopied documents and claims and leaked them out to the Daily Telegraph. The Telegraph then held a lot of them back and slowly leaked them out into the public so as to create the biggest fuss and damage. Amongst the highlights of the whole episode would be the special moat and castle for ducks and the MP's husband who claimed for watching pornography in a hotel.
By the way, that's foreplay for me.
You look so proud throughout that. Oh, your little boy. You're correct. Next up, I wanted to know who could be heard around Westminster shouting "Ayo, Girk Halley" while wielding a big knife. What did you all think?
Gurkhas!
This was Joanna Lumley representing the Gurkhas, Jonathan. It wasn't the Gurkha itself.
I bet they did as well. I bet some of them shouted, "Ayo, Girk Halley."
The person that was seen shouting was the lovely, fragrant national treasure that is Joanna Lumley, and she was supporting the Gurkhas because of her family history.
You know, the myth about the Gurkhas is, it might be a truth, is that once their weapon is unsheathed, it cannot be put away.
That's my policy.
It's been used. The Gurkha. For many years, she was a Gurkha.
OK, you've gone for David and Charlie, you've gone for...
We didn't know the answer and we guessed, and I think wrongly. So,
well, that's cleared that up very nicely, yeah. I feel.
We went Joanna Lumley.
Joanna Lumley is the correct answer. OK, I asked you what was going on with this hat. What did you all get?
Derek Acora held a sort of hour-long televised lie. he put on a voice in front of some very damaged people.
It was, of course, Derek Acora's live seance where he absolutely 100% for real contacted and channeled the spirit of Michael Jackson. Let's have a look at what Michael Jackson had to say from beyond the grave.
This here, the hat, Michael's hat. Would you like to touch it, any of you? OK.
I just can't believe that's his hat. Yeah. It's just amazing.
OK.
Just to see it not behind some glass or anything like that, it's actually there in front of me. Just amazing.
Will someone say hello to Quincy Jones for me? Please? You'll see Quincy. You say hello. Please?
Hello, Quincy.
One of them looks frighteningly like you.
What?
There you are.
If you put your face together with his face, you would have Roger Federer.
Or Ian Beale's daughter from EastEnders, one of them.
He got in touch with him. He didn't ask him anything about any of the allegations or how he died or anything like that. He talked about a bit about his hat for 20 minutes and said that he loved all his fans.
You imagine that if he had got in touch with a recently dead Michael Jackson, he would probably want to talk about the circumstances of his death as a priority. That would be much on his mind.
I think he warned him first. He said, none of that, Mike.
We're not going to ask you about that.
No.
But he presumably said, actually, I really want to talk about that because I just died under slightly odd circumstances and I want to clear it up. I'm pissed off. I died when I was 50. Despite all my wealth, I died under the average age of death. I didn't have a terminal disease. I'm angry about that. Now, we want to talk about your hat. I'm ringing off. One of them, he was looking at the hat of a man he admired. He couldn't believe it. I can't believe that that's his hat. Well, frankly, if you can't believe that's his hat, how the hell are you going to believe that this Liverpudlian is talking this?
That man would have been happy with a programme called Behold a Hat.
Yeah. Well, you all got that absolutely right. Great. Well done, you. OK, we heard a lyrical hitman, Jon Snow, reporting on one of this year's biggest anthems. Yep. But did you know what it was?
My wife is pretty sure that it's the Dizzy Rascal.
I'm not sure. I just guessed because he had a big song that I managed to not hear. I think it was something to do with Crazy. That's all I'm saying.
OK, you've gone for Dizzy Rascal. You've gone for the Dizzy Rascal. You've gone for Dizzy Rascal.
Bonkers. Because this song was bonkers, wasn't it?
Yeah, and they've got the answer absolutely right. The answer is... Well, let's have a little listen.
Bonkers.
Some people think I'm bonkers, but I just think I'm free. And I'm just living my life.
David.
Oh, I'm surprised you brought that up.
I didn't say anything. I merely couldn't resist the urge to move in time with the swaying beat.
Now it's time for another bonus round. This time, all the questions are about television. Charlie Brooker, you may have a slight advantage here. But first, let's have a look back at some of the TV highlights of the year.
This is the North.
We're talking about...
Gentlemen, let's cook.
Sorry, what? What did about murder?
They will either be falling at our feet or spitting in our eyes. What they won't be doing is ignoring us.
That's a year of my life right there. I hope you can see those.
Now, would you like a top-up?
No, I'm fine, thank you.
Feisty one, you are.
Why are you talking like that?
It was Yoda from Star Wars.
Okay, you saw the big balls from BBC's highbrow current affairs show Total Wipeout there. Can you name two other challenges featured on the series?
Oh, man, I know what they are.
Do they have official names?
They do have official names, and they all sound like things you might do in a bedroom.
I love the show, though, but I don't have another name. It's a brilliant show, though, isn't it?
Brilliant. I mean, brilliant.
If I tell you, I mean, I've already told you Big Balls is called Big Balls. They're not the most complex of names.
All right, well, this... OK,
they basically describe what's happened. Ah, Charlie Brooker's on it.
Yeah.
Are you having to explain what Total Wipeout is, Russell?
He says it's never entered his consciousness. He has no grasp of even the reason why such a show would exist, never mind who would watch it.
It's the best show.
You know why? Because we're lying in bed late at night, not together, I hasten to add, but we're lying in bed watching TV where he's out up to all sorts of hobgoblin nonsense.
It's on at 5:30, Jonathan.
I go to bed early.
OK, all right, let's see what you got.
Well, we got one. Well, Charlie knew one.
Well, I don't know if I know it. Do they use words to refer to the rounds on that programme?
They do, yeah. Dizzy Dummies is absolutely right.
Right.
Wow, well done.
Yeah.
The bit where they fall in the water.
That's all of it.
No, the rest of it is just the bit where they fall in the water again and again and again.
Don't you like it?
No.
I think it's Rachel.
It's one of the... It's a real sort of Marmite flipping thing, isn't it? Where you either get it or you don't. I just see people tumbling into the water 200 times in a row and it makes me quite angry.
I've even watched the same episode 3 or 4 times. That's how much I like it. And I managed to forget who's won and still get excited.
What is wrong with you?
I love
it. So many things.
Sometimes I watch episodes of Antiques Roadshow for the second time. That's a very lonely moment. Yeah. Initially, you don't know you've seen it before, and then you start to think you can guess how much things are worth. And then you think you're an antiques expert. You realise, no, it's not that.
We've got Big Balls Run, Slippery Slope Game, and Climb a Pole Game.
Who said it was stuff you could do in the bedroom?
My wife and I adore climbing up our slippery pole.
Russell, Jonathan, what did you get?
We put a tidal wave, and the other one, punch face, because I don't know what it's called, but there's quite a lot of things that hit people in the face. I tell you, we've got to go on this show. We could do it. We could win.
Could we?
I'll send you first for punch face, but I'll do tidal wave.
I think I know what you mean, the punch face. Yes, that is definitely the best bit.
The big piston punch
watching
face.
Watching someone walking along wondering if they're going to get punched in the face.
Punch in the face.
Get punched in the face. Yes.
And then they get back up and do it again. It's unbelievably good.
But the game's called, it's called Sucker Punch, that one.
Punch Face.
It's weird, it is the only place you can watch a woman being punched in the face, and it's Saturday Night Entertainment.
Okay, so Charlie, you're the only one that gets a point there for Dizzy Dummies. You could have had the qualifier, Sucker Punch, where you were very close, but you didn't get it. Human Merry-Go-Round, Donuts, Barrel Crossing, Water Wall, The Spinner, The Bruiser, Launch Pads.
Can I just ask you, what do you do in bed? The merry-go-round. Baby, it's time for the merry-go-round.
Merry-go-round. You want to go faster, you got to scream louder. OK. Who is this and what extraordinary spectacle is about to unfold?
Oh, I know what that is. You did the show.
I'll be disappointed if some of you haven't got this. OK, Russell and Jonathan? You got something?
Yes.
Yes.
What have you got?
That is Robert Webb, the dancing half of the Mitchell and Webb partnership, just about to launch into his mildly erotic version of Flashdance. And I don't think I'm the only man to have found that erotic, but I think I'm one of the few brave enough to admit it.
Yeah, I would agree, but I wouldn't have said mildly. Actively exciting. Rob, Claudia?
Flashdance, Robert Webb, comic relief.
Very good. Very
David,
good.
Did you
very
get good. This?
Yes, I got this. Yes, this may be one of the few dance questions I get. Yes, this is Robert Webb flash dancing.
Let's have a little look. Inspire you?
What can I say? We're very different people.
Robert's good at dancing, and David can guess antique prices if he's already seen it. Their talents are distributed equally across the partnership.
And of course, ladies love both those things.
Both those attributes are craved. That dancing's all right for a while, but pretty soon I think, what's that vase worth?
Okay, right, another quick look at the scores then. OK, I can tell you that Rob and Claudia have 14 points, Russell and Jonathan have 14 points, David and Charlie out in the lead with 15. Ooh. Now for the commercial break, where Rob Brydon will no doubt try and sell you some yoghurt insurance and toilet duck. See you in a moment. Welcome back, and as the six-pack of July sags into the love handles of August, let me remind you of what was in the news. Kerry Katona lost her endorsement deal after taking cocaine. We cannot be associated with someone so low rent and mired in scandal, said a spokesman for the cocaine industry. And the Athletics Federation launched an investigation after sprinter Caster Semenya was accused of being a man. I could have saved them time and money. Give me 45 minutes and a couple of Bacardi breezers. I'll tell you if she's a lady. A sports person with both sets of genitals. It's a footballer's dream. They could rape themselves.
Disgusting! Some people got grandchildren!
Some people have got standards. I'm phoning the mail.
You're a bastard!
Get back here. I've got photos of both of you. You've wandered off.
That was just for comedy.
We've just done that for a laugh. We will now continue with your quiz.
With your quiz. Okay. MI6 appointed a new head, Sir John Sawyer, but he was immediately plunged into controversy. Can you tell me why?
Yes.
Okay. MI6 controversy, you've all got something, okay?
Next.
What was Brazilian TV presenter Wallace Souza's novel method for boosting ratings for his Crime Watch style TV show?
Oh, no, I don't know what he did.
Mm. Whoa, what was that?
I've got a slight back issue.
I've got some back issues. If you want to have a look at them.
This summer, everyone was surprised and delighted as England won the Ashes. Our next question comes from cricketing hero, Stuart Broad.
Hi, Jimmy. What song did some cheeky Aussie fans sing about me during this year's Ashes?
Yeah, he does.
That you're 10?
That you were good in Harry Potter? Any of these could be.
I'm about to go to Montessori.
That cricketing would have got in the way of his revision, wouldn't it?
This is the song, this is the question. I know the answer because I have an unfair advantage because I met Stuart Paul.
That is
very nice.
What was the answer? What did he say?
I'm not telling you. If I tell you the answer, you'll romp to victory.
Okay.
We haven't got an answer.
You haven't got an answer for that?
No.
What song did they sing to that young man?
I know the question, I don't know the answer.
So, who surprised everyone by mounting a daring rescue of two female journalists imprisoned in North Korea?
Oh, I know this.
Yeah.
We know this, don't we?
We know this.
Understood.
Is it maths next?
Okay. For our next question, we go over to a genuine TV legend. It's Sir David Attenborough.
Ooh. Hello, Jimmy. Earlier this year, I had the great honour of having something named after me. Can your lovely teams tell me what it was?
You had something named after him. What was it? Okay, have you all got something for that?
Yeah.
Right, you are. Looking for answers? I got answers, I'll give you the answers. Okay. I asked you what controversy beset Sir John Sawyer immediately after he was appointed MI6 chief. Your thoughts.
Alrighty, here we go. This is to do with our old friend, the social networking site we call Facebook. Now, the wife of this man, silly old moo that she is, went and put some family holiday photographs. The sort of photographs that any family would take when on holiday. Quite incongruous, these photographs. However, when you're the head of MI5, you don't do it, girlfriend. She did it. What's he doing? He's doing something over there, isn't he? And I can't see it.
No, we're just enjoying listening to a man who appears to be 107 talking about Facebook.
When there's laughter, you just assume it's someone else.
I do. I assume something is happening over there.
You're a comedian.
OK, Charlie?
We put his wife put Facebook photos of him up on the internet. Yeah.
And you've gone for some sort of horrific...
No, that was Russell's clearly getting a bit bored and decided to be a bit rebellious.
I wondered if the pen would work outside of the agreed parameters.
See, this is how you always get yourself in trouble.
Metaphor for your life, isn't it? I wondered if the pen would work outside the given parameters.
Somebody's pen.
Facebook holiday pics, because
okay,
it was...
Well, you're all right. You've all got that. Absolutely.
But I think it'd be great. You should have more spies and stuff like that, because Twitter... I like Twitter, but it can be a bit dull. It's just someone saying, had a hangover last night, that pizza nearly finished me off, whoops. You know, it'd be great if it was Bond going, have my testicles almost mashed into a pulp by a man who bleeds out of one eye. Lol. That would be a much better tweet, wouldn't it?
I don't see what the harm is, as well, being up on Facebook, because he just has to not accept the friend. If Scaramanga goes on there, just deny it. OK. And next up, how did a Brazilian TV presenter boost ratings for his Crime Watch-style TV show? OK, Claudia Winkleman.
He commissioned
murder. So he presents a show a bit like Crime Watch. He commissioned people to be killed and then was first on the scene. And the police found out because every time they went to a murder scene, there he was filming, going, aha, let us look at the evidence.
John Nettles did that. They got a whole other series out of it. He did it once on Bergerac, and it worked. Midsummer Murders, that's what he's doing now. He kills people. The writers come in, sort of zhuzh it up a bit.
Bizarrely, you are absolutely right. This is allegedly, this guy ordered a series of murders so his cameras could be first on the scene to boost the ratings for his TV show. Who could stoop so low?
It's the equivalent of Jeremy Beadle commissioning people to put banana skins on pavements or put animals on
ice. It's worse than that, Rob, because of the murder.
What have you gone for? You've gone for killed someone.
Killed someone, we put, and then killed Jonathan has exclaimed it numerous times to emphasise how unusual a thing that truly is.
Well, he didn't kill anyone. He commissioned the murder.
By that logic, you'd let Charles Manson free.
Yes.
I would.
What do you want?
The voice in my mind is telling me no.
And the same as Charles Manson's mind, you're as bad as them. When's your spree? Are you going to kill someone to increase the ratings on this show? Because I'm prepared to die for this.
You have got the look about you of someone who would. I'm sorry, but it's good. It's in the eyes, cold like a fish.
Now he's Federer. When he does that, he's Federer. Yeah. Look at that.
Look at that. That's how he'd get past security with a tennis bag. And then when he got in, suddenly those tiny eyes open and he becomes a murderer. A cold-blooded murderer.
How did this go from you getting something wrong to me being a murderer?
Because we didn't get it wrong and you're murdering our hopes and dreams, Jimmy.
And you admitted to having voices in your mind, you sicko. What are they saying? Let's go down Whitechapel and stripe someone up.
Ah, the Ripper murders, finally. If you've just tuned into the Big Fat Quiz of the Year, business as usual.
Actually, they're sufficiently distant murders that people do have a bit of fun about them. It's the more recent murders that people are touchy about.
They're cheeky murders, like there's a fog and a top hat.
Yeah.
The good old days. Entrails as a scarf. Bit of fun. Not like your murders, you sick tennis playing fuck.
Don't applaud that. Okay, Stuart Broad asked you what was sung to him during the Ashes this year. What did you all get?
Yeah, dude looks like a lady. I feel pretty. I feel pretty. I feel. Was it that?
We didn't specify, we just said an erotic ballad. rather hauntingly beautiful and yet specifically genital song. It was sung by all the members of the MCC from the pavilion.
Let's go back to Stuart Broad for the answer.
The answer is, dude looks like a lady.
Aww.
Aww. He's past his bedtime.
Jonathan Russell, you got that right. I wanted to know who mounted a daring rescue of two female journalists imprisoned in North Korea. What have you got? Rob Brydon, very keen.
Mr. President, William Jefferson Clinton. Bill to his friends. Am I right?
You are absolutely right. Yes, it was Bill Clinton.
I'll tell you a thing about Bill Clinton. I was once at an event, and Bill Clinton was there, and my dear, dear friend, the splendid Irish celebrated actor James Nesbitt, went up to Bill Clinton, who was stood next to Uma Thurman, who had a very long dress on with a long train. And Jimmy went up and he went, Mr. President, I just want to say I'm doing James Nesbitt. He went up and he said, can I just want to say, Mr. President, that I really want to thank you for what you did with the peace process and blah, 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 blah. And Bill Clinton looked him in the eye and said, you're standing on Uma's train. Classy anecdote. That's it's too good for this show.
It was spoiled by the fact that your Jimmy Nesbitt impersonation sounds exactly like your Elvis Presley impersonation.
You got a good Elvis? Do a good Elvis.
I'll do my Elvis now, ready? Every dream I dream has come true 100
Jimmy
times.
Jimmy Nesbitt!
I have an extra fact about the Bill Clinton story if you want one.
Yes.
Oh, yeah, sure, why not? Go on.
Okay.
Here's hoping it goes as well as mine did.
No, they were offered to go and free these two journalists, Al Gore, and they said no. No, we want better, so Bill went.
Did Bill actually go? Did he actually go?
Yeah, he went. Yeah, he walked in the room.
I like that. It's like one of those films where, you know, like there's a professional, like normally a spy or a boxer, who is forced to come out of retirement against his better wishes. Yes. Normally starring either Sylvester Stallone or Steven Seagal, sometimes Mickey Rourke. And they're going, oh, well, this is Sylvester Stallone. He would go, look and learn, Rob. He would go, oh, they would go, you've got to. He'd go,
open to misinterpretation.
Let's have a look. Let's have a look at the celebration. This is Bill Clinton celebrating after the journalist got out. Have a look at this. Whoa, they're having a crazy time.
Hey, Jimmy, I wonder what Sylvester Stallone would have to say about this. Let's see.
Was that a cue for me, or...? You want to do one? OK, this is Mickey Rourke asking Sylvester Stallone... Yeah, what time was it?
I feel very bad. I have made my noses the whole time. I can't talk to anything about
I get a feeling all we need now is an anecdote with Mickey Rourke, Sylvester Stallone and Ronnie Corbett, and we are away. Oh, it's a perfect storm.
Oh, look, I look good. That's a good look. That is a very good look. Bloody hell, I look like Buddy Holly.
You do look like, you look a bit like Hugh Grant then for me.
Gosh, crikey, crikey, excellent gosh. No, I wondered if you fancied popping out into the car park and giving me a blow-by-blow account of what's been going on.
Let's move on. The legendary Sir David Attenborough asked you what was named after him this year. What have you all put?
We were a bit adrift here. We flailed around with star, penguin, mustard.
No. You've gone for...
We kept it general. We thought an animal. And that could mean either a whole species of animal or someone's specific pet.
Wrong again, I'm afraid. What have you gone for?
We were torn between either a shopping centre or possibly an insect.
Well, let's go back to Sir David for the answer.
The answer is that they named a giant rat-eating plant after me. It was called Nepenthes attenboroughi.
Oh, is that it?
That's it, yeah, and it eats rats.
A rat insect
plant that can eat a rat?
Mm. Yes.
Wow. Presumably the rat has to stay still for quite a long time.
It's got to be quite a docile rat.
Yeah.
Not
well,
the brightest.
Basically got to be a rat with a death wish. Yeah, when rats get really depressed, they know there's a certain sort of plant they sort of climb into.
But it's more assisted suicide than anything else, isn't it?
Well, the top bit looks like a lid, so I get the rat probably goes up there attracted by a smell, perhaps something sweet and tasty, and then the lid, boom, knocks him in the back like that. They should put that out in the jungle for the celebrities.
Have you ever killed,
killed a rat? I killed a mouse once because I was told to, and I really didn't enjoy the experience at all.
It's really hard. We had a rat, and I bought a rat trap, and it took several days to kill the rat. It just kept whittling bits off the rat. Sorry, it's true.
Whittling?
It took off its ear, then it took off part of its nose, then it took...
Yeah, what was this, like a sort of a room of knives? Does it get us in there?
I bought a rat trap from a pound
shop. You bought
shop.
A cheap rat trap?
Were you making Saw 7 with rats?
That was like a rat Nelson. That rat was a hero, Charlie. To the other rats, it would go back, yeah, I've lost an ear, but I'm still getting at Charlie's cheese. I'm living it.
Right, now it's time for another one of our patented bonus rounds. This one's all about movies. I'm going to show you pictures from three of this year's biggest films. They've been subtly altered to make it look like I was the star, which I would have been if I hadn't had other commitments. Here's the first one. OK, so you've got to tell me the name of the film. What's the matter with that? Why is that getting a giggle?
Nightmare on Any Street.
OK, and the next one? It's going to be like that. I think I look all right in that.
Nightmare in a Veil.
What's the matter with that? I look adorable.
I look adorable.
Okay, and the final one?
This is just you living out your fantasies, Jimmy, isn't it?
Okay, have you all got something down for this?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes, Jimmy.
So let's have a look. Okay, Jonathan.
Watchmen.
Watchmen is the first one. Let's have a look at the first one. That was, yes, in order. Dr. Manhattan from Watchmen.
We went Terminator, sorry.
Oh, yeah, with the big blue man. Yeah, I remember, yeah. OK, next one.
I think it looks like you've just remembered something terrible.
OK, you all got this, didn't you? Surely.
Easy. Slumdog.
Were you posing for these photos, or were these, like, frames taken?
No, they just found those. They just found these somewhere. I didn't
really?
Post them.
Yeah. The last one's really... I don't want to know where that came from.
I didn't even realise I had cameras in that place. I thought it was just a place where guys go to hang out. I think my face does look better than his. Look when it changes. Mickey Rourke in the rest of it.
No, I like that face. It looks like a kind of dolphin or something.
OK, let's have a quick look at the scores after all that. Rob and Claudia are behind. They've got 19. Russell and Jonathan have 20. In the lead, David and Charlie, the Dancing Queens, for 21. We've just had a complaint from Ofcom about one of the jokes in the last part, and as a result, we're going to be suspended for the next 2 minutes, and the show will be replaced by some adverts. Back with an apology after the break. Welcome back. It's autumn, and the golden browns and oranges you see everywhere can only mean one thing. You've got cataracts. Let me remind you what happened in September and October. Terry Wogan announced he was quitting Radio 2. He gently woke up millions every morning, but then so does a full bladder, and a full bladder doesn't force you to listen to Mick Hucknall and the fucking cause. And in Kent, a remote-control toy helicopter was used to smuggle drugs into a prison. Ooh, I bet that must have hurt. Now, inevitably, I've got more questions, ladies and gentlemen. OK. First up, we're back to the children of Mitchell Brook Primary School, my favourites. Yes. They have another one of their topical school plays for us. What are they acting out here? Have a look.
Hello, everybody. Here's the best person who's singing. Sighting.
Yeah!
Me!
Thank you, Ben. She's the best. Do you think it's naughty?
Yes, we're silly Billy.
They're just impossibly cute kids. What a silly Billy.
They're lovely.
Yeah, they're very nice. OK, right, next one. Why did 22,000 people complain about this woman? Well, I like her eye. I like the one that's looking at us, not the other one. I'm just saying I've got a favourite eye. I like that one. OK. Time for another Say What You See. We all love the Say What You Sees. Look down and say what you see.
Oh, yeah.
OK?
Nick Griffin.
Oh, well.
OK. The next question comes from retired Time Lord David Tennant.
Hello, Jimmy. As you know, I'm often seen in a rather unusual mode of transport, my 1987 Austin Allegro. But in October, which unusual mode of transport made six-year-old Falcon Heaney from Colorado internationally famous?
OK. You all got something? For 3 months, London's Trafalgar Square was home to artist Anthony Gormley's project One and Other, in which members of the public were each given an hour on the fourth plinth. Here are some of the highlights. Have a little look.
Makes you feel proud to be British. A moment of love, a dream, a laugh, a kiss. Our soldiers are brave men and I'm proud of them.
Wonderful. Okay, lots of British eccentrics there, but why did the police have to intervene when Simon Masterson from Yorkshire took to the plinth?
Oh.
I think that the plinth was excellent, don't you think? What an excellent scheme.
Oh, I agree, it was a good idea, yes.
Because it's like public spirited and things.
It's a very good idea.
It sort of just seemed somehow fun. I think they should have tried to do it forever, though.
Forever?
They should have said that forever there will, every hour, be a different live person on that plinth. Yeah. And then, like, in 2,000 years' time, they could say, this is like, there's an apostolic succession.
Yeah, but imagine...
The first person.
What if you were the one person who forgot and didn't turn up?
Imagine
the burden of guilt. Also, we'd
get killed for ruining it.
We'd get bored of it after about 2 years.
Not if there's the threat of death and then the body can be put on the plinth. It's a brilliant idea.
When we get bored of it, that's the moment to push on through.
Push on through!
That's what they did with Countdown.
Yeah! Let's go straight to the answers. Yeah. Let's not mess about. OK. We saw the children of Mitchell Brook Primary School acting out another school play. What story inspired them this time?
I don't know about that. I was in that one.
Yeah.
I hosted the VMAs. There was a bit where Kanye West came on stage and Taylor Swift was accepting an award. He come on, made an ill-judged attack on her, saying, oh, Beyonce should win all these awards. And I was watching it thinking, yes, yes, you take the fucking death threats this year. Go on, Kanye! Take the bullet!
Did you get death threats the year before?
Of course they give me death threats.
Did you say their president was retarded?
Yeah, I did say their president was retarded. I can take it. Bloody death. I'm immortal.
I think it's a little unfair to ask questions on an event that one of the panellists was at. It's like setting a question about the time I knocked a box of Cheerios off the island in the kitchen. I was there. It's an unfair advantage to brand.
Let's have a little look at the kid doing you. I think he nails you.
He's good.
Sighting.
Performance. What a gift that kid's got.
OK, David and Charlie, you went for Kanye Interrupting Awards?
Yes. Yeah. It was mainly an answer Charlie provided, I'll be honest.
Did you not watch the VMAs?
Not this year, no.
It was really ill.
Well, I did send a few death threats in,
obviously. Hey, that's me!
How many death threats did you get?
Loads! Well, there's just all these death threats. We had to get the old Bill involved.
Should we put an address up on the screen now in case anyone watching wants to? There we go.
Got a P.O. box.
That was quite a late support you gave me.
Don't get me killed. This is it. This is my... What if there is no reincarnation? I'll fuck this one right up.
Lovely. OK, I asked you... so well, you all got that, didn't you? Yes. Did you get that? No, sorry, what?
For some time.
Yes,
when
Rob.
Did you develop that stupid laugh?
It's not a stupid laugh. It's a grant. I know when I laugh, it sounds a bit like a seal is being molested. But...
What is it? Where did that come from?
It's my laugh.
Well, I would ditch it and ditch it now. Russell, give him a better laugh. What should his laugh be?
I think it's interesting that you've known him as long as you have and never heard him laugh. I think that's an indictment of you, Rob.
All the times Jimmy and I are together, we're normally watching your videos.
It is a slightly silly laugh. Let's move on. OK. I wanted to know why 22,000 people complained about this woman.
I'll tell you why. Because she's a silly sausage.
Oh, easy there.
That looks like Matt Lucas when he's dressed up as that woman on Little Britain. You know, the one with the huge body. The huge pubic wig.
No, I know who she is. She's Jan Moyer of the Daily Mail, who wrote that crass, horrible piece about Stephen Gately.
An evil piece about Stephen
Gately. Am I right?
You're absolutely right. Yes, she wrote an article, and there were lots of complaints that people thought it was homophobic about the tragic death of Stephen Gately.
She tried to wriggle out of it in a horrible way. Horrible, horrible, horrible. I'm being quite serious. It really was. It was horrible, horrible, horrible.
You don't want to roll that R so much when you're serious. It's like you're taking the piss out of him and all.
You can never do it. I can roll them. I just can't say them normally. I can roll them easy. Horrible, say... horrible, horrible.
Ooh, that's nice. That sounds like you're trying to cough something up.
Well, at least then I go, ho, 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 ho.
What was that?
This show just evolved into noisy.
Hang on, don't don't review the show while you're on it, Charlie.
Let's just do an hour of farmyard animal noises and all go home.
That's very good.
That's quite amazing.
I'm disappointed because when Claudia says, I'm going to do an horse, I perked up. Just for that. Well, hello. My luck's changed.
OK, you all got
I've
that right.
To it was Jimmy's laugh now. You've pointed out Jimmy's laugh to me.
It's terrible, isn't it? I know. It really breaks.
I didn't notice
I know.
It before.
Good, OK.
It's almost like...
Woody Woodpecker's arrived.
We cannot get into a position where none of us feel able to laugh. Instead of victimising the audience and taking the piss out of them, we all sit here in stony silence.
He's doing it!
It's an expression of joy.
OK, you all got that right. It was Jan Moyer and her article for the Daily Mail. OK, next up, it was the Say What You See.
Noel Eagle, light... No, it's Nick Griffin on Question Time.
It was Nick Griffin on Question Time.
Nick Griffin on Question Time.
Okay. Yes, we got
David Tennant asked you what mode of transport made 6-year-old Falcon Heaney from Colorado internationally famous. What have you got?
Balloon. Boy.
Hot air balloon.
Hot, it wasn't balloon.
Weather balloon.
Well, let's go back to David Tennant and see if you were right.
Falcon Heaney's parents claimed that their son had floated away in a homemade balloon, but they were telling porkies.
I thought the boy was in the balloon.
No, he was hiding.
He was hiding.
Why is he called Balloon Boy then?
You've really got to watch the news till the end.
I've got as much right to be Balloon Boy as him. I ain't been in one either. He's a Swiss.
You've got far too much attention already. You don't need the Balloon
Boy. I'll go in that balloon.
Well, that was sort of the point of it, was the American public were very upset because this boy was alive and well and not dead in a balloon.
They wanted a dead kid. They should get a dead kid. Floating across the sky, listlessly, scarring the horizon like a burned-up E.T.
A horrible image, but very poetic.
Well, you get...
OK, I asked you why the police had to intervene in Simon Masterson's stint on the fourth plinth in Trafalgar Square. What did you all put?
He stripped, he took his clothes off.
It was the British aversion to nudity reared its ugly head once again.
OK, and Russell, what did you go with?
He exposed himself in a hot air balloon.
Exposed himself, we put.
OK, well, let's have a look.
Did he strip right off then, or did he just go down to his pants?
That's surely not illegal.
That's
well, no, no. Basically, he was naked, which we haven't got the photo of that because he was naked.
Oh,
but then, and then the police came and said, "Could you put some pants on?" You've got to be very careful when you're in the public. You know, you can't just take off everything. Isn't that right, Russell?
Oh, fuck off.
That's quite a generous censored across.
Certainly
there,
is. Oh wait, I was on a lot of drugs back then. Don't know if I've mentioned it, and. It was cold. Look at the old Bill looking bored and him arresting me with one limp wrist.
But, you know what I like about pictures? The one with the limp wrist holding you up, he looks like he's giving you a prize and saying he's the champion. He's holding the best nude man today. First prize.
OK, time for another bonus round. What we're going to do, we're going to meet two people who made the news this year. All you need to do, panellists, is guess why they made the news. Let's bring on our mystery guests. These are our mystery guests. You can ask them questions, but they can only answer yes or no. That's all they're allowed to answer. They could say more.
The one on the right has entered a Francis Rossi dress-alike competition.
Did you follow Bilbo Baggins a long way while he was holding a ring?
I'm glad you are in here because I feel like we've got cabin fever, we've been snowbound, and new people turn up. It's a bonus.
Can you send help?
OK, yeah, just bark abuse at them.
Are you related to each other?
No.
Are you Scottish?
No.
Are you Irish?
No.
Are you English?
No.
Are you Welsh?
Yes.
I can spot them instantly. Yeah. Are you from South Wales?
Yes.
Are you from Port Talbot?
No.
Are you from Cardiff?
Are you
from Swansea? I'll take it from here, Russell. From Bridgend.
Can we just cut
through? From Shut Up, David. Are you from Kidwelly?
No. Sorry, are we going to establish whether they know your nana?
Is your being Welsh relevant to the news story you were involved in?
No. No.
Right. So going on about Wales.
Wales, this.
Are you in some sort of a civil partnership?
No.
Are you violent?
Yes.
Wow.
Did you? Okay.
Oh!
Did you?
Okay.
Write down your answers if you think you've got the answer.
Write down
the answers.
Hold it. Where's that pen? That pen's gone when we need it the most.
Oh, I know who you are.
You're panicking, man!
Well done.
This is why we made that call! Keep your head together! Just press one to delete the message! I told you!
Well done in advance for doing what you did, although it has yet to be revealed. I'm sure I know what it is, and I approve, and well done, and I wish more people did what you did.
I think you... And either we're really wrong, or you're...
Can we just see...
Or you're horrible.
Have you all got answers now? What have you got?
I thought, are you the guys who attacked the cage fighters who in drag?
No, they're the ones, they are the cage fighters, you idiots.
Okay.
You were the cage fighters who were dressed in drag, and two homophobes attacked you, and you schooled them with feet and fists and whatever the hell else you did. It's no holds barred.
So, guys, tell us in your own words what exactly happened.
We was opening a night out before we had a fight coming up. It was like 6 weeks before.
6 weeks before you were sort of going to have a proper cage fight.
Yeah.
Right.
And we decided to go dress as women.
You decided to go dressed as women. Yeah, should we have a little look at a picture? Let's have a look at a picture.
Yeah. Where was this? Where were you?
On Kingsway, Swansea.
Oh, fair enough.
By the way, Rob's thinking, oh, yeah, you can park around there, nice. Go on, so you were dressed up
as
ladies.
And James was walking in front of me, and two boys started on him. And then I come up to try and defuse the situation, but they... So I hit the both of them.
So you hit both of them? What were you doing? Just going off ladder my tights? You picked up your handbag?
Yeah.
You're my favourite. You guys, I think you all got it right.
Well, we got it right.
We got it more or less right. We were just a bit surprised.
No, you got it exactly wrong. You got it totally wrong.
We just flipped it a little bit. I thought you'd attack the guys.
For embarking on a homophobic attack, on our end-of-the-year celebration.
Welcome on a war hero. What regiment were you in? The SS.
Well, I was surprised that he was so happy about them.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, Daniel Lionheart Lurwell and James Lights Out Lily, the cross-dressing cage fighters. Give them a round of applause. OK, let's have a look and see what change there's been on the score front. Russell Brand, Jonathan Ross, Rob Brydon and Claudia Winkleman, neck and neck, 25 each.
It's like nothing's happened. We might as well not have done anything then. And who writes these numbers? Because it ain't us and yet the number's there.
OK, David Mitchell and Charlie Brooker are in the lead with 27 points. Well, I am bursting for a piece. I'll tell you what, I'll meet you back here in 2 minutes with more questions. See you then. Welcome back to the final part of the Big Fat Quiz. As the year drew to a close, so did the decade. And it was the last ever chance in our lifetime to wear novelty New Year's Eve glasses like these and still be able to see properly. I'm sure you can remember as far back as November and December, but for the benefit of any goldfish watching, here's what happened. Wayne Rooney successfully mated with a human woman. They had a baby boy. Colleen says she'll get back to work the minute she finds out what she actually does. There were severe floods in the northwest. Police strongly advised against fell walking in Cumbria because it is possible to die of boredom. In the wake of infidelity, Tiger Woods' wife rescued him from a car crash by smashing the back window of his vehicle with a golf club. She later heroically saved all his clothes from a house fire by throwing them onto the front lawn. OK, here come the questions. Have a look at this epic high-five fail at NASA HQ.
OK, all stations flight. Great job.
OK, something good's happened. Something good has happened.
Complete closeout of your...
It's gone brilliantly.
...flight products and get them on MDPS.
High-five. Yeah.
Oh.
He looked right at him and he moved on.
Oh, God, and now
we're just laughing at the poor bastard.
OK, what I want to know was, what were they attempting to celebrate?
Oh.
So it was a bit of good news for NASA.
All right. Yeah,
the moon?
Claudia Winkleman's got it. OK.
What did you say, what?
He said nothing. Claudia Winkleman's got it, and I, for one, can back him up on that.
OK. Who enraged the Irish in November?
Oh!
Oh, it's them.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Bring it on.
Russell, come on, you know this.
Yeah, we know this one.
Is this the longest you've ever gone without sex?
Yeah.
No, Russell has. You're a changed man, is he? You should share
Never.
Your joy. You're a changed man. You're no longer the promiscuous gadfly you were.
Yeah, no, that's true. Yeah. Well, because I've been like, look, I've really tried my hardest to sleep with all of you. But eventually, I had to be in a settled relationship because of the chronic loneliness of an evening.
And there was the danger of a latex shortage.
There's a latex shortage to worry about, viruses. I had a lot of concerns, so I've... Look, I can't help it. This isn't Dylan Goes Electric. I've just got a bird.
Your fidelity is being boomed by random women.
Luckily...
You're like women that have turned up at Thorpe Park and been too short to get on the ride.
Hey, no-one's too short to get on this ride.
Good news. OK. I'll have a look at this clip. What does this man know nothing about?
So what's been going on in there?
Not a lot, really. We don't really know what's going on, to tell you the truth, mate, so...
No celebrations or anything?
There's been loads, but they're not here.
Not here, no.
The jobs.
Where have they gone, do you know?
No, we don't know anything at all. We don't know anything.
Are they your age, sort of thing, or the older people?
I don't really know.
We're not saying anything, to be honest.
I don't really know. They're all sorts of ages. They're in a syndicate. I don't really know too much about who it was. Like I say,
how did you find out about it?
Excuse me.
Just point them out, really. The same as yourselves, you know, so...
You didn't hear the cheering or anything?
No, didn't.
What does he know anything about?
On fire. I'm suddenly come into business.
Ah, yeah. You've got the skills that pay the bills, Claudia Winkleman. So you have. OK. Our next question comes from the one and only Dr. Yes. David Starkey. Can you tell me whose historic saga is he recounting here?
It was here in London that two young Irish minstrel brothers sought the counsel of a rich and powerful judge famed for bewildering feats of alchemy, transforming lowly peasants into sought-after songsmiths. Oh, what a surprise to the natives of London their strange appearance must have been, each brother with an expression of demented enthusiasm and a towering shock of flaxen hair. The country was cloven in two. Some were charmed by the siblings' unusual interpretations of popular folk ballads, such as Ray Parker Jr.'s Ghostbuster. But others accused the judge of hubris and betraying the integrity of his high office. Unburdened by talent or charm, the duo soared to new heights. But perhaps like Icarus, they'd flown too close to the sun. And not even Ricky Martin's She Bangs. But just as quickly as they'd entered the kingdom, they were gone, forced to wander in the wilderness with Michelle McManus and same difference.
Dr. David Starkey there. I love the fact that someone could turn on Channel 4 at that moment and think, you know what, it has dumbed down. OK. Well, we'll go straight to the answers. Have you all got the answers down?
Yes.
OK. I asked you what prompted this embarrassing high-five fail at NASA. What have you all put?
It was the discovery of water on the moon.
We just put the moon.
Yeah.
So you thought they were celebrating the moon at NASA?
Why not? It's very nice up there shining down on us. Periods, the tide, wicked.
It's a very nice thing to think that every day NASA celebrate the continued
well,
existence.
Well, if you
of
bear
the
with
moon.
Us, that's why the other man wouldn't return the high five. He said, get over it, we've known about it for years.
Water on the moon is the correct answer. You don't get a point for the moon. OK, I wanted to know what enraged the Irish. What have you all got? I can't really make out anything
Henri,
there.
Henri.
H-E-N-R-I.
Can you say Henri there?
Yeah, it says Henri on the right
it's
there.
Okay, like all right, Henri.
H-E-N-R-Y. Henri, red rum, red rum.
Nice, nearly the splits as well, very nice.
Thanks.
OK, all right, well, you all got Thierry Henri because, of course, the French went through to the World Cup and the Irish didn't. That upset everyone.
Yeah. Yeah, it's well out of order.
Who gives a shit? France, Ireland, it's all abroad.
He seems to be saying exactly the same thing in that photo. Yeah, it's all abroad, don't worry about it. OK, so it was Thierry Henry's handball that upset the Irish. All right, what did the befuddled man not know anything about? Oh, Claudia Winkleman.
The lottery winners. They won over £90
million.
Half of £90 million.
And then there was a couple in Wales that got the other half.
Yeah. That's true, yes. A couple of cage fighters.
Come back. Well, you're all absolutely right.
Yay!
We heard a delightful tale from history, courtesy of Dr. David Starkey. But who was he telling us about? What have you all got?
We've got the Jedwoods.
Jedwood.
I'd like it if they were called the Jedwoods.
We've also gone with Jedwood.
Jedwood.
Let's have a look from David Starkey.
Hello, Jimmy. I was, of course, talking about John and Edward off of X Factor. Or Jedward, if you will. Good night, sweet princess.
David Starkey.
I think that's definitely the most frightening part of
the film. Truly sinister.
Oh, God, he's good. OK, now we come to the final round of the show. So, teams, this is your last chance to pick up a few extra points. And fittingly, it's the And Finally round, where we look back at some of the tiny but brilliant stories of the year, OK? Two buskers from Birmingham were given asbos, banning them from performing. What was particularly antisocial about their repertoire?
Oh, I got it.
So it's an antisocial busker. What would be the most annoying thing about a busker?
Good, good.
Okay. Can you cross out whatever you've written because it is too rude?
No! It's good! My judgment has never been wrong!
And also, all right, we'll cross it out.
I think that's definitely right.
Okay, you've written something. You have something. Okay,
it's a
so what have you got? Rob and Claudia, let's go to you first.
Rob's very upset with me because I wrote
They sang Phil Collins tunes.
Well, that might be amusing at the beginning.
Jonathan, Russell, what have you gone for?
You see what we've gone for?
Censorship. That's all we've come up with. Because we've been censored. Probably for our own good.
What did you get?
They used trombones made of lacquered shit.
And then we had a rethink and thought maybe what would be more likely was that would be the same song over and over again, and it doesn't matter what the song is, you just get maddened by its repetition. Even
that is absolutely correct. You get a point.
Well, just the same song over and over.
They knew Wonderwall and Faith, and they played them. That's all they played.
That's what. That's right. He's only got two albums. That's variety for him.
Paul Harris from Hull was upset by a letter he received from his local council a few weeks after being registered blind. What insensitive mistake had the council made?
Rude braille.
OK, David and Charlie, what have you gone for?
Free eye tests or something like that.
OK, I can tell you that's not right.
We've gone, well, but we had a bit of a Barney about it, is that they use the phrase, as you can see.
OK,
we've
gone
with
you,
they accuse him of being a peeping Tom.
We know you're peeping, Tom, and we're writing you a letter to validate that accusation. And we're not using Braille there.
OK, what actually happened was the local council addressed a letter to Mr. Blind Man.
That's fucked up.
And obviously...
If they put I would have thought
there's a couple of things there. Firstly, don't send a blind person a letter. Because his son then read it out to him. I blame the son for reading it out. OK, very last question of the quiz. Would-be burglars Matthew McNelly and Joey Miller from Iowa were branded most useless criminals due to their unusually crap means of disguise. Can you tell me how they disguise themselves?
Yes. It's a guess.
Bring on the point.
OK, what have you all got? Let's have a look.
They dress as each other.
OK, David, Charlie?
We thought that as burglars, like in traditional burglar outfits, but that wouldn't be nearly as stupid as each other.
You really leapt up like you genuinely knew that.
OK, Rob and Claudia?
We put parted their hair in the opposite direction.
That might be as good as ours.
I can tell you, you are all wrong. They actually... What they did... Well, have a look. Have a look at the disguises. that's right. They got a marker pen and painted masks on.
Oh.
And they were caught.
because it was magic marker and it wouldn't come off. They couldn't wash it off.
Nothing magic about that. It's horrible.
Well, without further ado, here are the final scores.
Oh, I got it.
You're competing for this magnificent trophy. Hang on. Ooh, hang on, that's heavier than it looks. Right, I can tell you, in last place, Jonathan Ross and Fuck. Russell Brand, as well as Michael. In second place, with 29 points, it's Rob Brydon and Claudia Winkleman. For the winners of the Big Fat Quiz of the Year 2009, it's David Mitchell and Charlie Brooker, gentlemen. So that's it for the Big Fat Quiz of the Year 2009. Hope you liked it, and if you did, you should have put a ring on it. We'll see you in 12 months' time for the Big Fat Quiz of the Year 2010, when we'll be talking about England's World Cup win, the Tory government, and the zombie uprising. Good night. Do you have anything to say?
No.
Do you have a dance you want to do?
No, I'd rather not do a dance.
Well, we could do this the easy way or the hard way.
Yeah. This is society at its ugliest.
So, no. But thanks for coming. And, bye.